Thanks everybody for coming here. I'll go ahead and call the order and roll call. Call the order.
Mr. Salcido?
Here.
Mrs. Hawkins?
Here.
Mrs. Dozal?
Here.
Mr. Wright?
Here.
Mr. Mitchell?
Here. All right. Board member and myself and a couple of them have asked to put a workshop together. Thanks you guys all for coming. Talk about making for a policy and moving forward. Received some information and went through and made some modifications based on wants, needs, trying to make this a policy for the district, and having some things that apply specifically to our district. And if we want to look, I just passed out one. If we want to take some time and kind of go through it, I can go through it with you.
Well, what is the one that you gave us compared to the one that is on there?
There's some things that were had been taken out. Verbiage change, grammatic errors were changed. Some things were added, some things were taken out.
So do we not need this one?
Well, yeah, we need them all, so we can look at some of the things and work on whether the changes or the one that's being proposed is workable for you. Like there's some things that some terminology that you like and don't like, those kind of things. So
this is going to need another go through Mr. Hosier as far as?
I don't think so.
Why not?
Well, because these particular things I think will satisfy the legal perspective of it and policy revisions that it went through.
Well, I have a question over.
Sure.
Okay. Because I see where Mr. Hodge struck out on recognition on A after the first sentence.
Uh-huh.
And that's back in now. Correct?
Well, yeah, Mr. Haas, his proposal, there were some things that were left and some things that were continued because of the policy that we need to look at.
My question would be, can I just ask him, why did you strike this out? What was the reason?
Recognition, paragraph A.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what my understanding is the board is considering is developing a policy, and that language that I struck out is basically a quote from an attorney general's opinion. I don't know if it is what it is. The quote doesn't need to be part of the board's policy. The quote is just to support the earlier sentence, and so that's why that particular portion I recommend striking out. There's nothing to your board policy about the legal authority. You cite an attorney general opinion and an out-of-state case. Of course, the out-of-state case isn't binding precedent in Arizona, but either way, the board policy is the initial sentence there that I left in the legal support for that sentence. I don't think it needs to be part of the policy, otherwise it gets to be longer than it needs to be. That's
see if I got all this stuff.
I mean, it doesn't hurt to have it in.
Well, the out-of-state case is not binding precedent in Arizona, so that is a concern. The Attorney General's opinions, their guidance to the board, if the court was to consider a situation and one of the sides gave the court an Attorney General opinion as authority, the court can deem that as persuasive. It's not binding authority on the court. And so it's guidance. again, Attorney General's opinion, you could have it in there. I don't think it's necessary for policy, because your policy is, you're recognizing the association. Why you're doing that, which is what the legal authority sets forth, I don't think you need to have that in your policy. Otherwise, why have it in A but not B? Why do you have legal authority in A but not B, C, or D? It just lengthens the policy. In my view, it's not necessary. It's not something that's still legal, but I just don't think it's necessary for a policy.
Okay, that's the third paragraph we're talking about?
It's the first paragraph.
H, recognition, paragraph A.
Recognition, okay, HA-1.
And you got a question in B. I mean, you strike out in B and then you put it right back in again?
Yeah, because I felt like it needed to be in there. And so as we go through and look at some of these things in the policies.
I guess it comes back to Mr. Hawes again. Why would you strike it out?
Not everything has to come back to Mr. Hawes. That the legal interpretation, and can I go ahead and talk about your document, Mr. Hawes?
If you want to.
Okay, so on the right-hand side, I guess there's, I'm taking this from a perspective that on the right-hand side was comments, maybe some legality issues, but other things that were in through here that were striking, comes down to an opinion, or does it come down to the legal perspective? I guess the thing is, what the meaning behind this?
Well, some of my recommendations are based on legal concerns about the board maintaining its statutory role, and things that you cannot by statute delegate to other people. So there's some legal concerns there. Some of my comments are not necessarily, this is illegal, you have to take it out.
Right.
But these are my recommendations to you as your lawyer.
Okay.
If you want me to explain in open meeting as to why I'm recommending certain things, I can do that. But it's a combination. Some things, I think some of the language that's proposed doesn't meet the legal requirements. Other parts, I would recommend changes that I think would be in the district's best interest.
I can't find policy HH on B, except for a set forth in policy HH. Am I missing?
There's an HI, Nancy, but not an HH. HI is the last one, rights and responsibilities of employees.
It says this recognition shall remain in place except as set forth in policy HH.
You know, I don't really, Mr. President, I don't really appreciate you dumping this document on us in a meeting without allowing us to have prior review of this document and expect us in a study session this evening to go forward and make a determination on how we're going to go forward with this, because there is a lot of information in this, and it's taken from stuff that Mr. Hawes has reviewed and given us an opinion on, is taken out, and you've gone and put it back in, and you dropped it on our desk here this evening, and expecting us. I mean, I don't know how much time you're going to give us to do this, and I don't know if we're going to have another study session to come back after we've had a time to sit and process this stuff on our own. and come back with our own questions to the board on what we think might, how we feel about this. But what is your expectation for this meeting tonight as far as what you dumped on our table?
Yeah, and I appreciate the word dumped, because this one was dumped on you the last board meeting.
Well, this one here is the one that you just gave.
No, it's pretty much, there's some tweaks.
Well, that's what I mean.
And the revision from Mr. Haas was also dumped on you a while ago.
Well, no, but this one here, you tweaked it and you dumped it on us today.
Exactly, and.
And so I don't think that's fair.
I don't understand the word dump, because.
Well, I mean.
This is.
There is.
This is a work session.
I know.
So we're bringing documents that come and craft a document. It's called a work study.
A study, but we didn't have prior time.
Right.
We didn't have prior time to look at this document.
You don't.
And.
So that's why we're working on this today.
Okay.
And I have asked you as a board member to give me information on how to.
Okay.
To critique this. This isn't an old document.
Well, it's.
And I have not received one thing on you from a board member about your input on the meet confer process. So anything and everything that you're gonna get is dumped, because you haven't responded to any kind of input.
But you made changes to the original document that's posted that we haven't seen tonight.
Right, that part of the work session.
Okay.
Yeah, we're taking information, we're gathering information from all the board members.
Fair enough.
And put this on here, and I dumped it on you.
You dumped it on.
I dumped it on.
Well, you're telling that, you're making changes that are going against our recommendation from our lawyer, so you're putting that onto the.
Yeah, some of it's recommendation, sure.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
And that's okay, because some of this stuff is our opinion, and it critiques to our district. We set policies, we're policy makers.
Right.
Right? And so when we make a policy, we critique a policy, then we ask for legal input from our attorney, and that's what we're doing. So we have the authority to make any kind of policy we want, and that's what we're doing tonight. We have a policy that we're looking at called the meet confer policy. And so when we want to craft a policy, we as board members are elected to make policy for our district.
And recommend.
Yeah, and so that's what we're doing tonight.
Okay.
And so when I brought this up on the last board meeting, we looked at it. I asked every board member in here for input. Mm-hmm. We got received only from two. So we had a work session to bring all these ideas together to create a policy.
Okay.
And that's what a workshop is. And that's what we're doing today.
Okay.
So today is the 25th, and our next board meeting is a week. So I would like some input as to.
I think we're all doing.
We can bring that up, and we're kind of
disregarding the elementary school board's meet and confer. I think that we did agree that we would like to see something that's a little more similar to that one.
And that's exactly what this is.
And so, no, this is not.
Sure, so the IBM process. So that's exactly what this is.
No, it's not.
It is. It's not going to have the same verbatim. It's not going to have some of the policies.
Explain the recognition B. How's this one?
The B, some parts aren't, but the whole.
So it's not.
The whole, not everything.
Okay.
It's not identical. You're right. But the foundation of it is. That's the meet confer. The meet confer process and how you go about the process. You meet and you confer. The bottom foundation of this process is going through an IBM.
So a union.
Union has nothing to do with it. It's a process. That's what I think you're getting mixed up here. This is a process, and that's what we're working on. To meet confer process.
So explain the process on B.
What? It's part of the process.
Well, explain this part.
B what?
On recognition HA recognition B.
Okay, and that is something that we can talk about.
Okay.
Absolutely. That's what the work study says.
That's what I'm asking.
Okay.
You wrote it, so I'm asking you what your interpretation of this is.
This recognition shall remain in full force unless during the month of September another organization with a verified membership of 30% of the total certified staff petitions an election and receives a majority of 51% endorsement in a scheduled election.
So meaning the association is granted not having the majority membership, not having being elected. They're basically, we're giving them, just like Mr. Haas said, we're giving them the same rights as an elected official like us, so we're gonna have to answer to them before we do anything.
They answer to us, or the board.
Is that how it's written?
Absolutely. What you're seeing here is the process.
I understand the process.
Right, yeah, and how to come up with a meeting for a process and who's represented. And so you take and represent, who is it you're going to represent in the IBM process?
So I'm confused on who the association is, because no one, we're...
It says right here.
But I think...
Now, let him finish reading what he's gonna say.
It's right here.
What is, read?
It's the Casa Grande Education Association.
And what is the Casa Grande Education Association? That's teachers, right?
Uh-huh.
All right, so we're a governing board, so we're not only taking, supporting the teachers, we're trying to support every entity of it.
Absolutely, that's why it's written in here, that we're gonna recognize everybody.
But they're not voting in here. I mean, they don't have an equal say.
Absolutely they do.
If you go to part, if you...
Is this on a new revision, or...
No, it's the old revision.
The fourth page talks about representation, about how it will be from the association, classified representatives, and the board of education.
They're gonna have to pay dues in order to be...
No, it's just like now, where they get to have representation at the table. It's just, it's the same thing as the process now. This one, it outlines every single step as to what happens here, and I think everybody that has attended is very happy with the way the process went this time. And this outlines the process as it was done.
Of the meet and confer that we've been at.
Yeah, it outlines the process and...
So if we're doing it right, why are we making changes?
It's not in writing.
That's right.
We were very lucky that this year, this is the first year it has been this way in several years. I don't know how many years it's been since we've had real confer.
We need a process, that's why we're here today.
No, I understand, but the process that we're following does not...
We need a revised policy.
It does not complement what we're reading right here.
I'm sorry?
Where doesn't it complement? Be specific, what do you mean?
First page. So why, I mean, I guess I'm hung up on CGEA. Why do they have equal say at the table? I mean, we're losing, we're the government.
Right.
They don't have it at this table, they have it at meet and confer.
Right.
Yeah, they'll bring a forth some kind of proposal, just like they did this year, and then we're the ones to vote on it.
Right.
And that's what this says. It doesn't say that they're going to be the ones that make the decision. We still...
I'm not tracking with that, but yeah.
The proposal will come to us, and then we can look at it.
I wanna get back to, to the opinion of our attorney. And I think it's very important that when you hire an attorney to get advice that you heed it, because he is trying to keep you out of trouble. And I believe that Mr. Haas has gone through here and done a good job of telling us where we're gonna get in trouble. And he's redlined all the issues that are in this document that potentially could get our district into trouble. And we're sitting here and we're saying that we don't respect his opinion, and we're going to leave that language in this document and move forward. And that's opening up us to all kinds of litigation issues that may come forward, as Mr. Haas has explained to us, that they have come in other districts. I believe that we can still achieve representation of the basic language of this MOU and get the representation of the CGA and our classified staff, and to put that into our regular meet and confer policy that's approved by the ASBA.
And I'll make comments to your two comments. There's one that Mr. Haas already indicated that this was some of his opinion. So not everything...
Yeah, he's smarter than us.
Right, but there's not...
He's seen things that happened with these kind of policies, and he's trying to tell us.
But there's many policies that have been out there, been in play, that he doesn't agree with. So that, there's some of his opinion. So things that are on
I like
here,
his opinion.
Okay, well, I'm sure, and so do I. But there, that's just that. There is opinion.
They're a good opinion.
Well, that's what you believe. Okay, because I have other things that
I represent the taxpayers of this district. And
sure you do.
And when somebody comes up and they're going to sue us because of language that we have in here that Mr. Hawes has already
what
told
language,
us.
What's it? Well, who's going to sue us over what language? Ask him.
Ask Mr. Hawes.
I don't know. You said that he's the one.
Who?
Tell him. Ask
who's
him.
Who's going to sue us, Mr. Hawes?
Well, if you exceed your authority or try to give away non-delegated duties, any taxpayer could bring an action in that regard.
And we have it.
Yeah. Where do we give away our duties?
Well, just going off the most recent point, paragraph B, the recognition paragraph B. Again, you already have a policy book that's about this thick. And one of those policies, HH, talks about employee meeting confer organizations. The content of that policy is not consistent with the language that I've struck through in paragraph B. That's why unless you want to go back and revise HH in this process, that's why I said this recognition shall remain in place except as set forth in policy HH. Because you already have a policy that talks about, you know, how you'll recognize groups and what that recognition would consist of. Part of what I think I bring to the board and to the district is an ability to help you synthesize all of your policies so we don't get one that's here and one that's over there and they conflict and then people ask why do you pass policies that don't even sync up with one another. So part of what my review tried to do as I went through here was not just look at the proposal in isolation, but try to make sure it was in sync with the other policies the board has already adopted. And when I saw differences, I tried to point those out. And that is one example, as is if you get down to paragraph E, where there's talk about what the district would do as far as giving the association preferential access or preferential treatment in various ways. That is also, in my view, not compatible with several of the policies you already have in place. And so part of what I hope to bring to the group is to not just look at one thing in isolation, but make sure that if you want to do this, that it's done in a way that's as consistent with what you've already adopted as can be.
Well, we have in our audience, I believe we have quite a few of our classified staff. Am I correct in that? We have quite a few people, our classified staff, that are sitting here and wondering, that are interested in being represented by this, by whatever document that we're going to approve. And I also have a document in front of me that says employee meet and confer organization, and it says support staff. Going back to our AFBA meet and confer document, I haven't read it completely, but we want to be inclusive on representing everybody within our school, and when we point, and when we single out the CGEA, that singles out one organization, and it leaves our support staff, our classified staff, in a limbo position. What I would like to see Mr. Hawes do is to take our current ASBA policy and take the marked up MOU that he's already reviewed and include language that also includes our classified staff to make sure they're equally represented in the negotiating process and in the IBM process, so that we have one document that is approved by the ASBA, that is approved by our board that we're working with. And so we're not working with two documents, the meets and confer policies of the ASBA, and then a separate MOU that somebody wants to bring forth and have us agree to that. What do you think, Mr. Hawes?
It's one viable option is to, you know, you have policies. If you want those policies to be the declarative statements of the board, you certainly can do that.
And would you describe?
I'll go ahead and address Mr. Haas when he talks about current policies, and that's really kind of what happens whenever you take on a policy. It supersedes existing policies because you're working on policies, but very much like when we had a cohesive governance, that great thing. It superseded everything else. So then we decided we were going to go back to other policies that mirrored the ASBA. So you're right. I mean, it came through with some of the stuff that did contradict, knowing that. I mean, we did know that it was going to contradict some of the policies we have because the policies we don't have aren't working. So the stuff on the side that you write, yeah, it does contradict. I understood that. I think we all understand that. But those will be invalid when we accept a new policy. So as policies go down, those are some things that we can look at to make sure it doesn't conflict. As far as the ASBA goes, that they make policies, and we can either take on those policies mm-hmm. or we don't have to. Mm-hmm. So the ASBA is not going to make any kind of comment about whether our policy is good or not. Mm-hmm. That they, just like the last one that we presented, or that I presented, they said talk with the and get legal on that. And we did get legal on that. Right. And so, and then there was legal, and now we've got legal on this.
Okay.
And
so going forward, we have just completed this afternoon, we have completed a 5-week process of a meet and confer process that we wanted to be successful. And we brought together three groups of our school organization, our administrative team, our classified staff, and our certified staff. They all got together for 5 weeks in a row with an excellent facilitator, Mr. Peters, who guided them through this process, and they didn't have an MOU to guide them through anything. All they had was a facilitator sitting over there in that spot over there that had them all working together. And they all managed in 5 weeks. And I only attended the last 2 weeks of these processes. And I got to say, I was very impressed with what happened here. And Mr. Gutierrez, he was a fine participant in this. He represented the classified staff, and he made his voice known that they need to be represented in this process. But we still did not have a formal document that required that everybody has to abide by these rules. And so they were abiding by just a good faith agreement by the fact that we wanted to get this done. And so the fact that we got it done means that we don't need this document.
Can I say something now?
But I'd like to, I want to address as far as the document that was dumped on you. It does indicate a certified staff, administrative staff,
yes.
and it's in there.
It does.
So when you talk about the fine people that are here that are need representation, that's this fine document. And that does. I mean, and you're right. When it comes to policies, you do have to write some stuff.
But we didn't have that the last 5 weeks, and we still got it done.
Remember that you asked that we move forward, and we asked the superintendent to go ahead and massage the current MOU or the meet and confer process.
Okay.
So there is a process.
I believe Nancy wants it to.
And on the other side of that? This is my fifth year, and it's the first time I've ever seen a process where everybody had a voice.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the very first time. No matter how many times it was requested, it's the first time I've seen it. So I do think we need a policy that dictates that this process. And yes, I think it was an error that the classified was not in there. I don't think anybody is, and the certified, I saw certified helping the heck out of the classified with their salaries, with everything else. I mean,
right.
I saw the certified helping the other entities
right.
in the meet and confer. So there is, I don't think anybody came to the table, and it, the classified was eliminated. It was discussed in the last board meeting. That was totally an error. Personally, I don't have a lot of problems with the parts that are marked out in this. I would like to see it a little bit shorter and simpler. But I do feel very, very strongly that, you know, you have to go from district to district, and everybody's in a different situation. And because I've seen 70, 80 teachers in this room asking for the process that we had today, and it's the first time I've ever seen it like this. So I think we need something that's going to dictate it, and I would like to see the association recognized. I realize they may not have a 51%, but I think if we could assure that they have a majority on the certified position, and I don't know how you would determine that, but I want to make sure that they have, they're the ones that have been the most knowledgeable, they have been the ones that have participated, they have been the ones that have, that they, and they've helped. I've not seen anything disrespectful or bad in any way, shape, or form come out of it. So far, and I think it needs to be fair to everybody, but I have not seen the teachers get their representation, and I want to see them get their representation, and I want to make sure that we continue with the process that we've had for the last 5 weeks. And I don't know how to do it other than to make a policy that does do it that's legal, and I'd like to see it shorter and simpler, and that things are...
Well, I think you said it. I think I like to see it much simpler and shorter.
But this doesn't work for us.
That doesn't work. I think what Mr. Haas has trimmed down with the original MOU, that he's taken the red light issues out of there as far as he's concerned, as far as in his legal opinion. But I think if Mr. Haas can help us craft something on the ASBA side that can do everything that you want and I want to do and include everybody and give a process without being...
That's not going to be shorter and simpler.
No.
And as we call everybody here to work on the policy. So
yeah.
I'd like to go through and talk, work on this policy as we go through and talk and see if there is some opinion like you've already given. But I did get some notes, and if we'd like to go through and take a few minutes to look over this and talk about some of these things that have been corrected.
All the red line stuff being put back in there.
What's that? Not everything.
The first page, everything that's redlined has been changed.
But that's why
I
can't read this tonight and
oh, you don't have to. But we'll go through it together.
I know.
So we want to take a few moments. If you want to compare Mr. Haas's recommendation to what's put forward, we can do that. Keep in mind that there's been some input prior
to
this.
B was my input right there.
I'm sorry?
B was my input because of HH that we have here now, is at 51%. That's why I requested that maybe the requirement be lowered to 30%.
Yeah.
For an association to be recognized.
And that's what we can do. I mean, there's nothing.
Well, I'm asking.
Oh, okay.
I'll just.
Maybe that wasn't the place to do it. Maybe it ought to stay in HH or something. I don't know.
Well, who you want to recognize, policy HH indicates how an organization is recognized.
But can those numbers be changed?
Sure.
Well, that's what I did. That's what I asked for. It came in under recognition, but I asked for the membership, the required membership, to be 30%, not 51.
And so, in my view, to have 20% in HH and 30% in what would be HA is problematic. That's what I'm trying to help avoid.
Right.
I don't believe there's anything in this policy that says it overrides any other policy that's inconsistent with it. So where there are inconsistencies, people pick the one that favors their view, and then we have, that's why I have a full-time job.
Yeah.
Is because there's people that don't get along with other people when that happens. They, where there's inconsistencies, they pick which one that they favor, and then that creates a dispute. So where there's policy in place, you can delete HH, incorporate it here, you can change the numbers in HH so that they match up with this, but I've just learned over the years that if...
I see we have two different things going on.
Yeah, and we focus on HA today, and we don't give HH or some other policy the attention it deserves, and then we've got, things that are inconsistent with one another, and that creates uncertainty, which we're trying to avoid.
I'm in favor of deleting HH and replacing it with HA. With this new thing, instead of having HH going and have the recognition and state it again, that way there would be no conflict.
Right. And that's where, once we get something that we like as a policy, then we go back and see the conflicts and then eliminate it.
Changing our standard from majority being 51 to 30, in your opinion, what do you think what are we doing to ourselves by decreasing the standard of what majority means?
Well, to be clear, HH, your current policy, says that you have to have 20% of professional staff members basically sign a written request to have a vote as to which organization is going to represent the classified employees. For example, AEA, there's a group affiliated with AEA, sometimes there's a group affiliated with AFT, American Federation of Teachers. They both are, battling to be the voice of the teachers. That's what this is addressing. Right now, you have to have 20% of the professional staff members say, we want to have a vote to say who's going to be our spokesperson, basically. And then a majority of the people voting, whoever gets, whether it's AEA or AFT or whatever, the majority rules, and that's the organization that would then speak on behalf of that group.
There was something that had a 51%.
Yes, and that's HA. Here, what you've got is you're limiting it to the month of September, which is not a restriction that's placed in HH currently. And so you need to decide, do we want to limit that to just September, or do you want to leave it whenever? And they have to have a verified membership of 30% of the total certified staff petitions. So you're going from 20% that would call for the election to 30%. Fine, you can do that.
I wasn't trying to go that way.
They have to receive.
They have to receive
51% under the new proposal. 51% of the vote in order to be recognized. Under your current policy, HH, simple majority rule, people don't call me to say everything went the way they wanted it to go. I get involved when one policy says majority rule and the other policy says 51% and the vote comes out in the middle. Then what do? So those are some of the reasons why there are differences between what you've got and what's being proposed. Those differences can easily be worked out. The board can direct, me or administration or whoever, which path you prefer, but my job is to point some of these things out so we measure twice, cut once.
Thank you. If we want to And just to highlight ideas that you did like, Tony, on the IBM process and procedures. We talked about the mirroring of the elementary school board process. And basically, whenever we talk about this base, I keep saying the word basically, but it really is. I mean, it's just a guideline to a meet and confer process. And it just spells it out on what happens. Conducting, or someone said about mediation. I've never seen it gone that far. And it probably will never go that far. But whenever you have a policy, if something does happen to go that far, you have to have something in there to catch it back. And you were concerned, Tony, about the power and the shifts and the delegation and things like that.
Well, that's more. I think Ms. Hawkins said it correctly, though. She's seen the best thing happen within the last 5 weeks come through from this group. But with all three, basically, entities being represented is very well. I mean, and I think, and so what I'm not seeing on here are with the changes and whatnot, how does each one of those entities have a voice? But I hadn't seen it yet because the first one wasn't the one I read, and now I need to look at it. So I need a little time to kind of. But that's my main concern, is making sure every entity has a voice out there. And, and Nancy said something about, I like to have the teachers have a little more, I guess, representation on it. If I heard you right, and which is.
I would like to see the association.
So yeah, that's the association. So the association, I just want to make sure we have a transparency of the other two entities, how they're going to be have a voice in there. So we want to make sure we have synergy between all three groups, which we're all boasting about right now. Right. I sat in one meeting and you could definitely see the process work. But the thing of it is, now you're talking about a procedure or a process right here. How do we make what we saw complement this? And so right now, this piece of paper does not complement what we're boasting about. Not yet. I mean, so
tell me how it's not.
Right now, I'm struggling on seeing how all three entities are going to have a voice.
It's right here.
Page 4, under 8, says balanced representation from the association.
Can we look at this?
Page 4 of the printout he just gave, under A, if you go to the second line, it says balanced representation from the association, classified representatives, and the Board of Education / administration. Yes, just ignore the typo.
Yeah, so I see that right now, but something that I do like about what the elementary school district, it defines it right off the bat. It shows where everybody sits.
Okay, well, we can move that right in front.
But yeah, we can move it around, but make it more transparent of where each one of our partners sit and what kind of role they have. So, I mean, those are the things that I'm looking at, and some of this stuff is on page 4, line 8. I mean, some of that stuff is... I think these folks right here want to know where they sit in this process.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought that up, because that's what today is looking at the content. And then if we want to massage it and look and put it somewhere and do this and do that, we can do that. One of the things that we talked about was 12 people and 18. That was the change, because we were focused on the teachers on that last one. But when we had someone that come in the audience and say, hey, certified and classified, we all want to be, we want to be represented, so that's where the change is.
Well, we just need some transparency on it, and that's what I'm saying. We just need it to be more transparent of what actually going to be, what our team is going to look like.
Okay, give me some.
No, I'm just sitting here. You have 12, comprised of 12 to 18 members. So how many are going to be association? How many are going to be... I mean, just kind of a breakdown of where...
Yeah, that spells out in the front.
No, I know, but it's kind of all over the place.
Classified.
Okay.
I mean, it could be simpler.
Okay. All right. So one of the things that going down on... yes, we on recognition HA1B...
Which one?
On the B recognition, we talked about the anything else, Tony?
I'm reading.
Okay.
I mean, some of the verbiage, like even on C, I mean, they're recommending that we use the word may be invited, and we put it in have the right to.
Right.
I mean,
yeah, and shall, because again, that goes back to one of those words, you know, that can be interpreted when some of this stuff.
Have the right to is a pretty strong word. I mean, basically,
whereabouts?
C
what? Under
recognition. Maybe invited is what they
recommend. We could just say shall participate.
Right. I mean, the word right kind of gives you entitlement. So
okay, we'll take that out. Just to highlight some of the things, at effective date and duration. This kind of goes back to some of the things.
What page are you on?
It's going to be information and exchanges, so I'm going to look at page 3, 8,
8-2.
Let's see here, effective exchange. Yeah. Some of the things that was witnessed when we talked about the process and adopting a policy, if we look at B, for instance, what we talked about, and this was brought up by Mr. Hawes last time, about timelines and so forth, converted into, there it says 3 school days prior to the next scheduled meeting. Instead of saying it has to be done by a certain time, I think when we're looking for information that needs to come to the IBM process, that if we look at it in reverse, and this was recommended based on having some information so the process runs easier and a little bit easier to manage. So we look about a policy, and we're looking at putting things in writing, as Nancy wants. Those are some of the things that helps the process work. And so it's just little things like that.
What page are you on?
Yeah.
Let's see. It's going to be
the third page.
Third page,
H-A-2. Paragraph B.
Yes.
Again, I mean, he puts a reasonable time. You put a specific date.
I put a reasonable time. Not dates, but reasonable time.
3 days.
So when we determine what's reasonable, those are those things that kind of make it tough because it depends on the document. So, but if you do it in reverse, instead of saying you got 10 days to do it, it might be 15 days, it might be 30 days, but they need to have the information to conduct the meeting 3 days in advance, so they can go over the information and make sound judgment. So if they can't get it within that timeline, or they can't do it within 3 days, then they need to either kick the issue down to the next meeting or get other resources to get the information.
I mean, I think Chuck is right on all this stuff. There's a lot of, I mean, I hear you. Our lawyer is a recommendation, I mean, so we can take it for what it's worth.
Uh-huh.
But I'm going to I put a lot of value in it. So we're sitting here right now. There's a lot of red lines in this thing right here. So, uh-huh. I mean, it'd be more probably productive, at least on my part, if I had time to go through this. This sitting here talking through this is kind of premature of doing something correct. I mean, I don't know what we do as far as adjourning, probably do this again where we have time to kind of go over some of this stuff. It's not like one or two lines that he's making recommendations on. I mean, a lot of the stuff right here.
But there's nothing more going to be added. It's either in it or taken away. So this document has been reviewed. What I'm saying, there's nothing really added, anything.
No, I agree. But the thing is, we need kind of the time to go through each. When we just skipped over.
Well, that's why we had a work session. This document's been out for a month.
No, and I read.
No, not the one you dumped on it.
I didn't dump, but there's not any changes, like
well,
you
yeah,
said.
Yeah, there are changes on it.
But some of the changes have been.
But there's still changes, Wes.
Right, and
there's still changes that we haven't seen them until tonight.
Yeah, you have.
No, you haven't.
Why haven't you?
Because you just dumped on this.
No, that's the combination of these two policies. No,
but we haven't seen it in, we haven't seen it in this form. That okay, we want to discuss this form right here, and we're bouncing back and forth between these two documents and the one Mr. Haas gave us, and you're asking us to make.
I'm not bouncing anything. We're not bouncing at all. All we're doing is taking the one document, and we're having the legal opinion. Versus this one,
yeah.
And we're discussing it.
And we are.
And this has been out a month ago. There's a lot of red lines. And so some of the red lines are in, some of them are not.
Yeah. And I'm not comfortable whether we want to put the red lines back in there.
Well, then why didn't you send me something in the email?
Because I didn't know you were going to put it all back in.
Why wouldn't I?
Well, I mean, you had your right to.
Sure.
But now you had your right to discuss. Wes, you're trying to dump this on us.
We've had this for 4 days. If you were going to do that, you should have said that's not for four days. Wes, the red one?
No.
Well, I have a problem with the 3 days. I think we can't put a day on it.
Okay.
I like having the 3 days because I know I have asked for information. Some people have called me testy for asking too many questions. But if I don't get the information prior to a meeting, then I can't make a good decision.
Well, thank you. That's what I'm talking about this.
But this one, you know, where it says 3 days, I think that is a valid, you know, and then, like Wes said, if it's not within 3 days prior to a scheduled meeting, then it needs to be tabled. That there has to be a timeline because I'm still waiting for questions.
Is that from the certified staff? It encompasses everything.
You know, classified
There's
answers
no
and things. Certified has asked for things, administration has asked for things, everybody's asked for things. I'm still waiting for answers for questions from January, and I still don't have them. So asking for 3 school days is not a good thing.
Depends on what it is.
Can I offer something? A couple of options. If you went through the meet and confer process and it worked this time, you may want to consider just memorializing the process. We basically borrowed the elementary school district's process. If you liked it, we could come up with a written, proposal that you could then adopt that would track the process that you just went through, if that worked. Then you could tweak it, and adjust it and whatever. That's one option. If you want to have your own policy, we can do that. And if you want, I can explain some of the reasons for the changes that I recognized and what I was thinking and why I've made some of the additions or deletions to the policy. For example, your point about this, what I suggested was that the superintendent have a reasonable amount of time to respond to the request for information. That's not a math problem, which can be frustrating because people don't like to be put off. People don't like to be stonewalled. But there's a whole range of requests. Some are narrow, some are broad, and how much time is needed to appropriately respond is not, that's not a one-size-fits-all thing. A concern, for example, with the language here, the new language, which is better than the original language if we only have 5 school days to respond. Now this is, you'll have, the administration would have to provide the information within 3 school days prior to the next scheduled meeting. That's good on the one hand because it gives the group 3 days to get it, consider it, digest it, and come to you with reasoned feedback from an important contingency of this district. Again, I'm sure your teachers are great. I see things from a warped perspective, I'll admit to that. One concern I would have with this language of you have to, the organization has to get the information within 3 days before the meeting, is there's no restriction on them making the request 4 days before the meeting. And then you're right back in the soup of not having an appropriate amount of time to gather the information, and you encourage gamesmanship, in a sense. I'm not suggesting anybody here would do that. Again, part of what my job is to, you know, throw up red flags or to say, here's how this could go wrong. But if you have to give the information 3 days ahead of time, and there's no requirement on when that request must be made, you're inviting gamesmanship. And that's a problem that can be easily addressed. Again, I'm not suggesting that would is the intent of this language, not suggesting people would try to do that. I just see the world in a different way than many people do, because people don't call me to say the process went great, everybody got along fine.
And so that's when you say reason to try, that's all up for interpretation.
Can we ask the audience, you know, when they would think would be, when they would make your request? You know, I guess I would like to know what would be after having a meeting and for a meeting. You normally would have the request right then.
Yeah, Liz, I think it's pertaining to the information to be received by. They can make the request at the meeting, but then the information that they have to be 3 days. Is that on
the phone? Yeah. Is that so? Most of the time they would make the request at the meeting and then just all their information, but they wouldn't. Is there anything in here saying that you can't just ask 4 days before the meeting for the information?
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
And then, oh, we expect the answer tomorrow.
Definitely.
You know, most requests, I think, come during the meeting.
And I think we put the timeline, like, for the scope. We did put, you know, five items.
Yeah.
Because that could be all out. And I think it would just be the nature of the process that those requests are going to be made at the meeting.
Could we include something that would say, you know, that not, you know, to give the administration so much time to process the request?
Sure. But then that we go back to, do we use the term reasonable time, or do we go back to...
No, I'd like to have a number.
10 days?
I'd like to have a number. I'm just not really good.
I know on the FOIA request, because I've looked it up as far as the law, it says reasonable.
It just says reasonable?
It says reasonable.
The public records law is a reasonable amount of time to recognize some requests are small and can be done in 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a reasonable amount of time. Others, you know, are large and take a bunch of time, and it depends on when the request is made.
Right.
You know, whether it's, so the Federal Freedom of Information Act, there's presumption on most requests of 20 days, 20 calendar, 20 business days, which may be, you know, a bit, maybe longer than what you need in most situations here. But my concern with this would be if you have a deadline when the stuff has to be provided, but no deadline when the stuff has to be requested, that is going to, at a minimum, create frustration for the people that have to try to turn it around so quickly.
So it says, upon request of the IBM team, a copy of materials to public inspection. Do we need to put in there somewhere, like you said, must be asked at the time of the meeting, or
the challenge is that you need to process the request, what would be considered reasonable.
You know, I've really never had a problem with the word. We get information and we get requests, and we try to crank that information out as fast as we can. I will tell you that we do have a limited district office staff. That was done by design by our Auditor General reports in regards to the amount of monies that we allocate towards administration overhead. So we are pretty lean, but we are mean and mighty up here. So my best information to you, if you left the word reasonable, I think that that's pretty much fine. I mean, and overall, I think we do a pretty good job in regards to getting information out for whomever requests it. Heather requests information all the time from me. So have we been reasonable so far?
So far.
So far, there you go.
I guess we can just put it in there, and then if there's a problem, it needs to be, yeah, then we can just revise it.
I like that you've cleaned up the meeting procedures, the steps under the interstate negotiations. Instead of elaborating on what, tell the story, identify the interest. I like that that has been.
Keep in mind, I was trying to be as specific as I can.
That was.
I'm trying to eliminate any kind of interpretation that might become difficult or heated.
I also appreciate that you kept those lines that said it's under HA3, effective date and duration, part C, which is on page 3. Any modification of the agreement will not be voted on by the board until alternatives are discussed in IBN, so that maybe some alternatives could come up through the process.
What are you talking about with experiment?
It's the, on page 3, it's part C. And it's the last sentence, any modification.
Okay.
Just so that they, it's not that they are making a decision, it's just that maybe they come up with a great idea. I think we have some wonderful people on this committee.
And you see if there's timelines in there as far as March, September, again, just organizing the process.
Do you notice the elementary district meet every month? Anyone know? Because I know they have monthly meetings right now. And their superintendent is always in attendance.
Who's that? What did you ask?
The elementary district, do they meet every month throughout the year, their IBN, IBBC?
They meet in January. I asked Heather Rice yesterday. They meet in January all the way until June once a month.
Okay.
And so your paragraph C says that the board can't do anything until it goes back and have the alternative discussed in the IBM process. And so that's tying the board's hands again. And Tony's mentioned that that's taking any control out of the board's hands.
See, I don't view it that way. I view it as looking for some alternative solutions to problems. Like when they had to do the cuts, when they had to also have their furlough date. They, you know, that went back to IBN, they discussed it, and then classified and had input into this. It wasn't that it was a good input. I felt bad for them having the furlough dates, but at least it wasn't just given to them and that was it. I would like to see any problem that comes up go back to the whole committee. I don't think we should just alone make the decision.
If I may comment,
yes, please do.
you know, a possible alternative would be to say that modifications of the agreement would typically be sent back to IBM, or, you know, customarily or something like that. I would be uncomfortable with any modification having to go through this process, because this process, as it's contemplated in this new version from this evening, is not going to be quick. If people, particularly if you have an outside mediator, I don't know if that's still, you know, if that's been reinserted or not, but if you're involving outside people, an outside entity, and outside parties, that has been one of my original concerns, is you have been elected. That mediator was not elected. That mediator is not responsive to this community necessarily. And so, if it goes back and people come up with a good creative solution, great. Everybody's in favor of that. Again, I'm looking at it from the worst case scenario. You saying any agreement has to go through the IBM process, which includes outside mediation, that is not going to lead to a quick solution, and on some very sensitive issues may create some frustration with the board.
So I'm good with
modify that.
Well, we can take out the whole mediation. The only reason why I left it in there is so that, because it's an alternative. If it's just another process. So if things don't work out within the IBM process, we kick it back down, then there's a process. And F clarifies everything.
Which
the mediator shall not have power that would bind either party and the board. Plain and simple.
So I guess what I'd like to have somebody speak of is when we go through this whole process and all the entities in the meet and confer go through and give us a recommendation, and it comes to the board, and the board goes, we appreciate it, we respect it, but we choose not to go with it. What happens then? Do we go back?
We have to explain that and then send it back for them to work on it.
So are we going to sit? So do we have to sit there as a board? We made a decision. So do we send that back to the IBM, and they're going to give us another proposal? And then are we going to sit here with five different proposals again and not get anywhere? When do we say, okay, you know what, I agree to disagree with what's going on? So when we say, you know what, classified or whatever, that was a great idea, but at this moment we're going to have to pass on that.
Yeah,
what happens?
Well, that it goes back to our discussion a while ago about committees and what do you exercise and use a committee for. So if it's going to be a recommendation, it's going to be given to the board. And as a board, we have that, like you said, right, as a committee that we want to adhere, and we put faith in that committee, that's what the direction of the superintendent and the board and everything else. Because superintendent represents us.
Right.
So hopefully anything that does come to us, we wouldn't have to turn it down, because that's already
worked out. I'm just sitting here just kind of like Mr. Haas's red lines here. You said it right now, but this is a recommendation. You have to listen to it. And so that's the same thing. It's a recommendation that the board gave us. So when we sit here as a board, we go, you know what? It's a great idea. Thank you for your effort. You're totally respect what you're saying, but we're going to have to pass on it this time.
So we got that right to do that.
No. So I'm just asking now. So does it go back to the IBM group? Are we going to have to sit there and wait for them to give us another proposal, or is that it?
Well, we have the right to veto it and send it back, and have them work on something. But hopefully our representation will have that fixed, so that when it comes, it's ready for us. Because that knowledge and the expectations for the superintendent, the representation of a board, then whenever it comes to us, it should be satisfied.
But I'm just saying, there's going to be a time where we don't agree with it. So, I mean, so that's what, are we going to sit there and just keep on going until they give us the answer we want, or how's that work, though?
I was saying, you can kick back until we get what we want. We're the governing board.
But if we said no, and that no means no.
Right.
I mean,
absolutely.
So do we stop there, or do we keep
Absolutely.
Okay, and that's what I'm saying. I go, so is this process down here, it goes back to IBM. I mean, so basically they gave us their best shot. We looked at it, we considered it, and we respected it. Well, we said no.
Right.
And is that, so we proceed, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just want to make sure, because some of this verbiage in here doesn't read that way.
Well, sure. At the end, it says, shall have the power that will not bind the parties. We make that decision.
Yeah, what about the mediator?
That's what I'm talking about down here.
Yeah. So some of the verbiage is, you can take it for what you want, but that's, I just want to make sure it's clear.
So what are we doing about C?
Which one?
Yeah. Are we taking the whole paragraph out, or just saying it's possible any modification?
I thought you said it possible.
Which one?
C.
Paragraph C.
Under which one? Representation or interest-based, IBM, or?
It would be page 3 of 5.
H.A. 4.
H.A. 3C.
Take that off.
Are you saying HA 3?
HA 4.
The effective deed and duration, right?
Yes. Uh-huh. I'm trying to think of something that might
which
be.
Which paragraph are we talking about? Sorry.
Again, it's C, it's on page 3.
Page 3? HA 3.
Effective deed and duration.
Okay.
Paragraph C.
Last
sentence. Yeah. I'm trying to think of something that might be in the agreement that would be. That the board would need to change that we wouldn't want to go back and talk to IBM. You know, the things that came out of me today.
Well, you said you could modify it, not to have any modification, but you need to modify it. And I agree with that.
And what? How was the wording?
Well, you would have the wording.
Any modification of the agreement will typically not be voted on by the board.
Okay.
Customarily not be voted on by the board.
Okay.
Well, I think Tony kind of wants that, right?
What's that?
Any modification of the agreement will not be voted on by the board until alternatives are discussed in IBM. And you were saying that could be, present a big problem, saying that we always have to go back to IBM or any. And you were saying you liked it, so there's an in between.
Well, I didn't see those two separate issues. If there's going to be a modification of the agreement, as I struck out the wording that it would have to be sent back to IBM before it came back to you. I think, as I've said, the board is the ultimate decision maker. Two heads are better than one. You oftentimes get good information and input from other people, but ultimately the buck stops with you. And I don't think that you should have to go back to the IBM process in every instance. That's a separate issue from what happens if the process works and the association and the administration come up with a plan that they're okay with recommending to you, but you don't like it for some reason. I believe your concern is, do you then just say go back and try again, or do you say thanks for your recommendations and we'll go ahead and make our decision based on all factors, including the recommendation of the confer team? I don't think that process is addressed by HA Roman numeral 3, so paragraph C.
Do you have language that would be in between, you know, where everything has to go back, you know, between striking it and not striking it? You know, I would like to still see something in there that we do go back, that it doesn't have to be.
And my thought on that was that you could just say modifications of the agreement will typically not be voted on by the board until it's gone through IBM. That's going to be the customary process. That would be the way it would normally work.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
But there may be situations where you already know what you're going to do, or that process is going to be too time consuming, or you've already done it, you don't want to do it, you mess with it again. I think there's some value in preserving the board's ability to say, okay, we've got the information we need to make our decision. We don't need to go back for another round of this.
I get concerned whenever, if there's no agreement, then everything gets constantly kicked up to the board. You know, if there's something that says, you guys need to figure this whole thing out, and
our role is
we don't want to make, what's that?
I mean, so that is our role.
Absolutely. And so, but we want this role to be the paramount, you follow me? That's what we want. We want the teachers to come in and represent what they want. We want this, you know, certified, classified, support, administration, everybody to come in and have a process. And so that's what this will focus on. And then if there's not an agreement with everybody, then everything will just keep getting kicked up. And then we need to have something that says it needs to be kicked back down. So, because we'll get everything. And we'll have the ultimate say. And where was that, Nancy?
Change it to typically.
Huh?
Yeah, change paragraph C to typically instead of any.
C, and what?
What is on page two? What is right now, what is the process for the association being able to transact business on different property and different things? Paragraph C.
I left some of those things in there just for management, is there's a lot of things that have in order for this process to work and to be affluent and to have an organization. There's some management, there's some stuff that needs to happen. And so we talk about, you know, places to either to meet or to mail service, having communication, all those kind of things.
So are we going to discriminate against the other parties? But it doesn't say it in here.
There's no discrimination. The association. So association.
Association means teachers.
No.
That's what the definition is.
Right, but in a sense of association, so it could be.
We need to clarify that.
Okay.
I mean, next.
I might be able to assist you on that. According to law, if you let one group in, let's say a church or a youth soccer league, then you got to let all groups in.
Sure.
So even if that group is a group you don't like, in regards to some sort of a religious affiliation or those types of things that may not be appreciative of what the school stands for, but you can't be discriminatory. So if we allow one, we allow all. So if I allow one, so I allow all.
Right. And there's nothing discriminatory. There should be nothing in here that discriminates from any, whether it's classified, certified, support, administration, whatever. What's that?
It needs to say something like that.
Okay, yeah, that's what we're here for.
Otherwise, it would be discriminatory.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think when they talk about the association, it could be plural. So it could be classified association, whatever
you want to look at. I'll give you my thoughts on why. Information, here's what we found, here's what we learned. Here's our initial suggestion to the group. I don't view that as a subcommittee,
okay,
unless you call it a subcommittee. And when you're talking about meeting procedures, the more you make, the more you limit people.
Mm-hmm. Was my actual comment as well, exactly what Rob says. The board has the right, if they want to, according to policy, to create a subcommittee anytime that they want. But that's the board's committee. I'd recommend really that if you look at it, this body of support staff and teachers and administrators wants to create a subcommittee to look at something, let them do it. That's their business. That's not really any of my business. That really shouldn't be any business of the board. That's just that group or that organization doing the work of that group or that organization. And they can decide that amongst themselves pretty much at any time if that's what they choose to do.
Well,
if that makes sense.
Strike out paragraph 7, because 6 takes care of it.
Are we striking the sentence on paragraph 4?
Yeah.
Subcommittees?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, if they want to form a group to look at special parking spaces for staff, all right, y'all form a group and y'all talk about it. You know, that really doesn't have any bearing, because ultimately that committee has to bring that recommendation back to the whole, and then that whole has to make a recommendation. They give that recommendation to me, I take a look at it, and we bring it forward to the board. So, you know, just leave the, let the committee do the work.
How about paragraph five?
Yeah, it doesn't have anything to do with subject matter.
The number eight was no problem.
The paragraph five is good?
Yeah.
He's giving me all the time, please, and meet you as good as I can. Okay.
Is there any problem with eight?
Did you see?
No, red marks on it.
So six, paragraph six is pertinent, right? Paragraph six is pertinent, right?
Yes.
Okay. Paragraph eight, we're keeping?
Yeah.
Both parties recognize the right, each party communicate. I mean, isn't that a given, well, don't we already assume that?
It passed his test, so I'm good with it.
Okay, we start this month?
But we got a lot of givens, sir.
Keep it, still recognize the right to communicate.
Yeah, okay, now we're down to F, right?
Right.
Okay.
Do you see anything wrong with that?
Number one?
Number one?
Yes.
Commission can be filed, I mean, it's gonna be...
Down there, 10 days from the date.
Okay, three, the board may or shall?
Shall. Shall adopt or reject?
He's saying may, give us your reason for may, Bob.
If IBMP shall have 10 days from the date that the tenant is promised, is that where you're at?
Yeah.
Bob.
So what about the...
Your view on may, paragraph three?
Again, just flexibility for the board, I don't know when this recommendation will come to you. You're talking about the association then going out and presenting the agreement to its membership to ratify. We don't know when that will happen relative to the board meeting. So I'm just giving you some additional flexibility. Everybody's gonna wanna get resolved as soon as you can. Shall is mandatory.
Mandatory.
It gives us the flexibility. What if we had a meeting tonight and they approved everything?
The board may, okay.
May says they may not even do it at all.
Oh.
That's how I...
You know, and I guess, yeah, and we have the option of adopting or rejecting.
What are we doing about the IBMP shall have 10 days from the date? Are we keeping the 10 days? That's what we were talking about, wasn't it?
Or no?
Once the agreement is made, do you think having 10 days to go out to the staff works per vote? Up to 10 days?
Yeah, I mean, we can probably do it in less time if we get actual language to get out to people. If we got the language tomorrow, we send it out to people tomorrow and say, hey, you got a week, you know, 10 days would be the maximum, I would think.
So 10 days? I'm okay with 10 days.
Okay, 10 days is good. Okay.
Yeah, they usually get it turned around really quick. People want it in their contract.
Okay. Paragraph four, is that... That's a good one.
Yeah, no red mark.
Are we gonna strike mediation?
Well, and again, I think the catch-all is down on three and with letter F. Again, if we don't feel like mediation is ever gonna get there, then all this is just a catch clause. I mean, we gotta have an end to the process.
Can we say something simple like, we can do mediation and everything else will be assumed? Or do we have to specifically spell out how we're gonna do mediation?
they don't have to spell out the details of how the mediation is going to be conducted or any of that type of thing. And I would advise against that.
Take number three and cross out and below that.
And again, just from a philosophical point of view, from the board's control over its operations, the board's sense of responsibility over the district, and the board's accountability to the community, to send this off to a third party, the Federal Mediation Conciliation Service, I just don't see any reason to recommend that.
Well, it does catch that even though it is sent out, we still have the ultimate decision. Now the F.
I like 3F.
Right.
John, I'm out of power.
You like what? 3F, that paragraph. I'm just not sure where to, because it says
the board retains its power. Have power that will bind either party, and the board retains its power to adopt the terms and conditions upon that provided under interim law.
Okay. So it goes through the process. Even though it goes through a process, we still have the ultimate on that decision when we want to adhere to that decision.
But we're striking everything in three except for F.
Yeah. Another point on that is oftentimes these outside mediation arbitration groups have their own set of rules that talk about, you know, how it's going to proceed and what happens if a decision maker makes a decision and where you can, is in an appeal, right, and all of that. I am not familiar with Federal Mediation and Conciliation Services. I don't know what value they can bring to the process that this board can't do. As I've said, I just don't think it's I would not advise involving outside parties to address it. If your team can't resolve things, that's a sign to me that there's bigger problems what items you're going to negotiate on or whatever. If your team can't even get past this process where they have to involve a mediator, that's an ineffective process in my view.
That's a process that's troubling with the facilitator.
So maybe do not paragraph one after agreement, comma, go down to the board retains its power to adopt the terms and conditions and unless we're going to go. Have you ever gone, seen a mediation in work, at work?
No, and usually this, and that's what I'm saying, all of this really is the last ditch effort. And like Mr. Ott said, typically it really should never even come down to this. Only reason why this is in here is just because of policy, in that there has to be a final conclusion, and how do you obtain that final conclusion? And so it's the process.
Well, since none of us have ever seen it, maybe take away shall.
There you go again. Being back to May, so then
yeah, I know.
This
but
process
May,
becomes
but it seems
invalid.
Yeah.
What if we kept all of paragraph one and then made F of paragraph two rather than saying it has to go to the FMCS? And
there you go.
That we do send it to a mediator. We shall send it to a mediator. And then note that the mediator shall not have the power to bind either party.
Okay.
Would that be enough to?
I think what this does is spells out who the mediator is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think paragraph two talks, hits two different things. One, identifies the mediator, and it also identifies the cost.
Is
that the same?
But you know what, if we get to that point, we're gonna be watching.
This, again, this process is supposed to be set up so we don't have to be involved.
Well, I understand, but, you know.
Is that the group used for the mediator for, like, the fire?
You know, we never had to do that.
Okay, do you know where this came from, Nathan, the FNCS, the Federal Mediation and Consolation Services?
The writer at ADA.
Okay.
Probably just went off of other policies he's either written or familiar with.
I feel better with May.
Are we striking paragraph one?
No, I like paragraph one.
Hmm?
I like paragraph one a lot.
Are we striking paragraph two?
We're still talking. But we're moving F up.
Yeah.
We like F.
So we're striking 3A through C, 3A through E?
Yeah.
We're striking all of that?
Yeah.
A through E?
Yeah.
Okay.
So what if we do 1, 2, 3?
With
the F being the number 3?
Okay.
Can I make a suggestion? Mm-hmm. No one here knows anything about the Federal Mediation and Conciliation Service. I don't know why you would box yourself into using it.
No.
Well, we can box us into a mediator.
Yeah, mediator would be fine.
But then we're going to determine, then it goes back, well, who?
The board may request a mediator.
Well, that gives us options. Rather than,
okay.
Shall request.
The board may request a mediator.
Yeah. Shall request.
A mediator?
Yeah.
And then generally
you can say the district and association will agree upon a mediator.
Okay.
They'll agree upon a mediator.
You got this down, right?
And I would say, if you're going to do that, then the last sentence should be kept also about it. If there's cost, there's split.
Okay.
Yeah, we like that.
No, in that last paragraph, or last sentence in that paragraph. And then that doesn't cost.
Okay, so the paragraph two is the district and association shall agree upon mediation. In the event there are costs associated with the mediation, both parties shall share those costs equally.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And then paragraph three, conduct the mediation, is going to be paragraph F.
Yeah, I would just take out and just.
And the mediator.
Just make number three.
And we're going to be mediator may.
No, shall.
Shall.
Shall not have the power.
Okay.
That's good.
Shall not have the power. Okay. Okay. Here we go.
Your typing skills are going to be put to the test. You can refer back to the videotape in case you have any questions.
Yes.
Okay. Who's going to retype it up?
I will.
And then we'll submit it.
You've got all the notes?
If you send it to me, I'll look it over with my.
You got all the notes?
Okay, I do.
You got all the corrections?
Yes, sir.
Unless you want
to Xerox yours, give me yours. Okay.
Yes, you want to submit it to Mr. Haas one more time after.
One more time,
or
just
no?
Yeah.
Any legality,
but then it has to be back.
I won't make additional. I'm gonna,
okay.
I'll just double check
okay.
My his notes versus my notes.
Okay.
I won't, rehash things that you've already kind of processed.
Yeah, that. But if you see something where we've missed something and it's illegal, let's do that.
Yeah.
We're not illegal.
we're already illegal. We've already passed that point.
Trump's going to go get all those illegal.
Dumping documents on us.
I didn't dump anything. Work in progress. Chat.
Okay. Can we have an adjournment?
Yeah, we'll call out.
Yeah.
In a second.
All right, we adjourn.